You're listening to the audio production of Signs and Secrets of the Messiah, Audio Bible Studies by Rabbi Jason Sobel, published by Harper Christian Resources and presented by the author. These audio studies are a unique learning experience. Unlike a traditional audiobook's direct narration of a book's text, this production includes high-quality live recordings that cover the important points from each chapter, as well as relevant material from other sources.
Shalom, I'm Rabbi Jason Sobel, and I want to welcome you to this study on signs and secrets of the Messiah. The purpose of the study is to help see God's miracles from the book of John in a fresh new way that increases our faith in them for our lives, and it also helps us to see the miracles in the ministry of Jesus in HD, high definition. You know, deeper spiritual truths are often not obvious on the surface, but as you dig, they can be found, and it's the glory of the King to seek them out, to meditate and search these secrets and mysteries. Jesus gives us a great example on the road to Emmaus in Luke 24. He's walking with his disciples, and he begins to open the law, the writings, and the prophets and show how they all point to him. And they said, did our hearts not burn within us after their eyes had been opened and realized that it had been Jesus who had been journeying with them all along? That's what I hope we experience in part. But before we begin, there are a few things that are important to understand. The Hebrew name of Jesus is Yeshua. This is a name that he would have been called by his parents and disciples, and I will be using Yeshua as well as Jesus throughout the series. Something else that is important to know is that Hebrew and Greek is alphanumeric. This means that every letter has a number assigned to it. In fact, there are no Roman numerals in the Bible. You actually write numbers with letters in Hebrew. This means that every word in the Bible, both old and new, has a numerical value. Words that share the same numerical value often have a connection that gives us deeper insights and understanding. An example of that is the number 13. We tend to think of that in the West as an unlucky number, but in the Bible and in Jewish thought, it is a very important and beautiful number. The value of echad, to become one, or to unite, or unity, has a numerical value of 13. And the Hebrew word for love, ahava, has a numerical value of 13. Why? Because love 13 is about oneness 13. It's about becoming one with the one we love. So for example, the husband and the wife, the two shall become echad, basar echad in Hebrew. And it's also significant, to fish in Hebrew has a numerical value of 13. Why does that all connect? We must fish 13 from a place of love 13 to help people unite 13 and become 1:13 with the Lord. But of course, there is more. The great love chapter in the New Testament is 1 Corinthians chapter 13. And guess how many verses it has? 13 verses. This is no coincidence. Even though the chapters and verses in the Bible come later and are not in the original manuscripts, God knew all of this from the beginning. So the Bible often uses numbers and patterns, and there is a significance to many of these numbers and patterns. But for the sake of clarity, I want us to understand that we don't make doctrines or build theology based on the numbers, but they do illustrate and give us deeper insights of obvious spiritual truths that are in the biblical text. Also in the study, I'm going to reference Jewish tradition, several sources that come from a Jewish perspective, and many of these are centuries old and ancient. And these sources help us open up the Jewish meaning of many of the passages that we're going to be looking at and their connection to the Messiah and the New Testament. Just as Christian pastors and teachers use multiple sources to explain Scripture, we are bringing together the essential sources from a Jewish perspective to study the Messiah. And with that, I'm excited to jump into the first miracle of the Messiah, the signs and secrets of transformation. Messiah's first miracle occurred during a wedding, and it points to the abundant blessing that comes from our relationship with Messiah Yeshua. His changing the water into wine was not merely a random act of kindness, as many seem to look at it at first. God is sovereign over every seemingly insignificant detail, and the fact that this miracle involved wine and occurred at a Jewish wedding is highly significant. But we have to ask the question, why did this first miracle happen at a wedding, of all the places? Throughout Scripture, God's relationship with His people is often symbolized spiritually and prophetically as God being married to His people. God is the groom, Israel is the bride. Ezekiel 16:8 says this, "Again, I passed by you and saw you, and behold, you were truly at the time of love. I spread the corner of my garment over you and covered your nakedness. I swore to you and entered into covenant with you, says Adonai, so you became mine." A beautiful verse of talking about God marrying His people. And the marriage imagery of God to His people in the Old Testament is evident in Yeshua's first miracle at a wedding. The miracle was actually a prophetic sign of the coming messianic wedding that we will celebrate with Yeshua Jesus, our bridegroom, in the messianic kingdom. Yeshua is Israel's bridegroom, and He's also ours. It's symbolic of God saying, "I'm going to reward you and bring you to me as my wife." So it makes sense that this miracle of abundance occurred at a wedding, because Yeshua is the bridegroom and He was coming for His bride. Hosea 2:19 and 20 says this, "I will betroth you to me forever. I will betroth you to me in righteousness and justice, in love and compassion. I will betroth you to me in faithfulness, and you will acknowledge the Lord." God wants to be your betrothed. Yeshua performed this first miracle at a wedding feast as a sneak preview of the ultimate wedding celebration, the messianic wedding supper of the Lamb, spoken of by the prophets in the book of Revelation. May that day come soon. It's going to be such a great celebration. But I want to look with you at another important detail in this miracle. The miracle and the secret of the third day. The miracle of the water into wine happened on the third day. But why the third day? What's so significant? Let's explore the secret of the third day to uncover some of the deeper truths about why Yeshua did this first miracle on this specific day. The story of this miracle opens with the words, "On the third day." There was a wedding at Cana in the Galilee. The third day of the week is significant in Jewish tradition. In fact, there are three parts of the Jewish wedding. There is the shidduchin, which is the matchmaking. Then there is the betrothal, known as the arusin. And then there is the kiddushin, which is the setting apart or the sanctification, and culminates in nisuin, which is the actual wedding coming together. So there are three parts: the matchmaking, the engagement, and the wedding. Many Jewish people are married on the third day. And the reason for this is that the third day was the only day in creation that God blessed twice. And so many Jewish people get married on the third day because they believe it is a day doubly blessed. It is an auspicious day. But of course, there is more. Why does this miracle happen on the third day? Well, because it is about a miracle of abundance. It comes from our relationship with the Messiah. So therefore, we have this miracle performed on a day that's doubly blessed, symbolizing a double portion and of fruitfulness that our marriages.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.